we are going to discuss about neutrons. How neutrons were discovered, what were the basic properties of the neutron, and also we shall be discussing how to calculate the mass and wavelength of the neutron, and what are the different types of neutrons that could be found. So, first of all, let us go to the history of neutrons, that how neutrons were discovered. So, neutrons were discovered by, not exactly by Bethe and Becker. One day what happened, Bethe and Becker in 1930, they performed an experiment. What they did, they struck the polonium on a silver plate. When they struck the polonium on silver plate, some alpha particles had come out. Alpha particles were emitted. So these alpha particles, when they were made to strike the beryllium metal, so some penetrating rays came out of the beryllium metal. These penetrating rays were to be of gamma rays. So what Bethe and Becker observed in 1930, that when these alpha particles are striking the beryllium metal, so they artificially transformed into carbon-13 isotope and gamma rays were emitted out. So this experiment was further carried by Irene Curie and Joliet Curie. So Curie was the same. So Curie, what they did, they performed with these gamma rays that they had penetrated out of the beryllium metal. They made to strike these penetrating rays on the paraffin wax. So when the gamma rays struck the paraffin wax, then some fast moving protons had ejected out. So they thought that a proton of the order of 7 mega electron volts are coming out. Here Irene Curie and Joliet Curie had just missed the chance of discovering a new particle, that was neutron. So they thought that the particle that is emitted out from the paraffin when the gamma rays struck the paraffin, they thought that the particles that are emitted are protons instead of neutrons. So when Chadwick in 1930 performed the same experiment, when he struck the penetrating rays with the paraffin, he said that the protons are not liberated in this reaction. Instead, a similar particle like proton, but it is neutral in nature, that particle is emitted out, and because the particle is neutral, he named that particle as neutron. So what he said, he carried out the whole experiment and said that when the alpha particle strikes the beryllium metal, very high penetrating rays, and when these penetrating rays are striking the paraffin wax, a neutron particle is ejected, and he named that neutral particles as neutrons. And he compiled the reaction as that the alpha particle striking the beryllium metal forms a carbon-12 isotope and a neutral particle, that is the neutron. And for this discovery of the neutral particle, that is the neutron, he got a Nobel Prize. So that is why he said that the alpha particles that is coming out when the polonium is striking the silver metal, so when these penetrating rays were impinged upon the block of paraffin, emitted uncharged highly speed particles with mass equal to the same of that of the proton, but it had a neutral charge, and these particles were named as neutrons. So this reaction can also be represented like this, that this is your alpha particle, a very small alpha particle is striking a beryllium metal, liberating a carbon-12, forming a daughter nucleus carbon-12, and a very high speed neutron is liberated in this reaction. So in this way we can come out with a beam of neutrons using these reactions. So there were many types of neutrons discovered. Neutrons could be slow neutrons, neutrons could be fast neutrons, or neutrons could be, the third type is the thermal neutron. So those neutrons which have energy less than 1 mega electron volt, those neutrons whose energy is less than 1 mega electron volt, those neutrons are said to be slow neutrons or low energy neutrons. And those neutrons which are having the energy lying between the range 1 mega electron volt to 100 mega electron volt, they are classified as fast neutrons or highly energetic neutron. But the neutrons which have the energy equivalent to KT, where K is the Boltzmann constant and T is the temperature, room temperature. If we take the room temperature to be 27 degrees Celsius, what will be the temperature in Kelvin? That is 300 Kelvin. So the energy corresponding to the KT amount of energy, so that is 0.026 electron volts. So the energy, the neutron having 0.026 corresponding to KT amount of energy, those neutrons are said to be called as the thermal neutrons. So basically there are three types of neutrons: slow neutron, fast neutron and thermal neutron. Neutron having energy less than 1, slow. Neutron having energy more than 1, ranging from 1 mega electron volt to 100 mega electron volt, are regarded as fast moving electrons. And the neutrons which have the energy lying with, which are the neutrons having the energy equal to KT, that is 0.026 electron volt, they are said to be thermal neutrons. So next we move to the properties of neutron. As you are aware from this discovery of neutral particles, that is the neutrons, that the neutron do not carry any charge. So the neutral, so there is a property, that is they are neutral, they do not carry any charge, they are uncharged particle. Here also we had said that Irene Curie had just missed the possibility of telling that the particle liberated from the paraffin was not proton instead of, it was a proton instead of a neutron. So what did Chadwick say? He said that a similar particle to the proton was liberated, but the difference was that it is not carrying any charge. So that is why the mass of the neutron is comparable to the mass of the proton. Moreover, it is having a mass slightly greater than the mass of proton. So the mass of neutron is found to be 1.008665 atomic mass units, whereas the mass of proton is just 1.007277 AMU. You can see here the difference between the masses of the neutron and proton is very, very small. So the mass of the neutron is just comparable to the mass of proton, but it is on the higher side. The mass of neutron is a little bit greater than the mass of proton. Third property is that it is having high penetration power. As we have said that it is a neutral particle, it is uncharged particle. Since the neutron is an uncharged particle, it would not be attracted or deflected by any of the molecules in its path. So when it is going to hit a particular target, it is not going to be deflected, it is going to attack straight and it would not be deflected. So it would not be slowed down by any of the ionizing atoms along their path when they come close to the target. So it penetrates deep inside the target nucleus. So the penetration power or the penetration depth is very high in the case of neutrons. So I think you must be clear that the particles are neutral, they have no charge. The mass of the neutron is higher than the mass of the proton, or it is comparable, and it is having high penetration power. The fourth property is that it is used as an ideal projectile for carrying out the nuclear transmutation reactions. So here you can see that if the beam of neutron is striking the nitrogen 14, what daughter nucleus is formed? We are getting boron 11 and alpha particles are emitted out. So such type of reaction are termed as an alpha reaction, where we want some alpha particles. So alpha particles can be ejected from a lighter nuclei by just striking it by the neutrons. Similarly, the magnesium can be made to liberate a proton by when the neutron is hitting the magnesium. So magnesium gets converted into sodium and a proton is liberated. Similarly, when neutron strikes the cobalt, it forms an isotope cobalt 60 and gamma rays are produced. So we can produce gamma rays by striking the neutron with the target nucleus. Similarly, when mercury is being struck by the neutrons, gold is created and a proton is liberated. So isn't this reaction quite interesting? we can create gold by striking the neutron with mercury. But why don't we prepare gold using such type of reaction? Why do we go for the natural gold? Because the cost of this reaction, the cost to carry out this reaction, that the neutron is made to strike the mercury to create gold, that cost is very, very high. This cost is so high that it is very high as compared to the natural gold that is found. So it would be easier to take the natural gold instead to create gold in the laboratory, which is a very expensive project. So that is why, but although we can create gold in the laboratory by using this reaction. So in this way, we can see that neutron acts as an ideal projectile for carrying out the nuclear transmutation reaction. Next property is that it has low ionizing power. As you know that the penetration power was high, it was uncharged particle, it was not getting deflected. So similarly, if there are any molecules in the path, it will not ionize the molecules of the air or any medium. So its ionizing power is very, very small. It does not create any ion pairs as it moves along its path. Next is that the neutron is regarded as the fermion. Fermion means that the particles which obey the Fermi-Dirac statistics. So we know already that proton, electrons all obey Fermi-Dirac statistics. So neutron also falls into the same category of protons and electrons, and neutron is also a Fermi-Dirac, following Fermi-Dirac statistics, and also regarded as a fermion. And you know that fermions have an half integral spin. So the spin of the neutron can take a value of either plus half or minus half. It can be up spin or it could be down spin. Similarly, we can produce intensive beams of neutrons. So when we have intensive beams of neutrons, we can replace the X-rays by these neutron particles. So the intensive beams of neutrons are produced replacing the X-rays where high penetration of the radiations are required. So where high penetration required, instead of using X-rays, we use these neutron beams to penetrate deep inside the sheets, thin films. So the last property that would I would say that it is a of the free neutron. So what do you mean by free neutron? Free neutron, although we know that protons and neutrons are bound inside the nucleus. So where does the free neutron come? If we know that the proton and neutrons are surrounded by the meson cloud, and during their meson cloud conversions, so a proton is converting into a neutron, and we suppose that the neutron is ejected out of the nucleus. So the neutron that is not present inside the nucleus is regarded to as the free neutron. So the free neutron is the neutron that is present outside the nucleus, and this free neutron is very, very unstable. It cannot live outside the nucleus for quite a long time. It is unstable, and it is found that the half-life time of the neutron, free neutron, is just 10.8 minutes. It can only remain for 10.8 minutes outside the nucleus. Half-life time is only 10.8 minutes. So it will disintegrate into other elementary particles. So we have the reaction that a free neutron decays into a proton and an electron and an antineutrino. So we can see that what is the decay scheme, that is the of the neutron, that the neutron is converting into a proton, emitting an electron, and an elementary particle associated with the electron is the antineutrino. Same here, if we say that we have proton, so if proton is being converted into a neutron, so we will be having a positron and a neutrino. So electron is always associated with the elementary particle, that is the antineutrino, whereas the positron is always associated with the elementary particle, neutrino. So we see that free neutron is very unstable, and it will decay into a proton, liberating electron as well as an antineutrino. So the properties of neutrons are that they are neutral, mass of the neutron is higher than the mass of the proton, it has high penetration power, it can penetrate deep, quite deep inside the target elements, or it is used as an ideal projectile where we can also form the gold in the laboratories. Although the process is quite expensive, it has low ionizing power because it is neutral. It is regarded as a fermion having a spin of half integral, either it is up spin or down spin as in the case of protons or electrons. And the intensive beams of neutrons are replacing the X-rays where we want to penetrate deep inside the films. And the free neutron is extremely unstable and it decays to form a proton, electron and a antineutrino. So these were the properties of neutron. So now let us study how to calculate the mass and wavelength of neutron. So here what we do, we take a head-on collision. So here we have a neutron and we have a target nucleus. So what we do a head-on collision. So in this head-on collision, what is happening? The target nucleus is supposed to be at rest. It is moving with, it is not moving with any velocities. It is having a velocity u2 equal to 0. And let the mass of the nucleus, target nucleus be m2. Similarly, let the mass of the neutron be m1. And since it is a head-on collision, it is moving with some particular speed. So let the speed of the neutron be u1. So when there is a head-on collision, what happens that this target nucleus starts moving in the same direction as the neutron was moving. So now what happened that this neutron has got its new velocity due to the collision, and let the final velocity be v1, and the target nucleus which had got a head-on collision with the neutron is now started moving with a velocity of v2, but in a direction parallel to the direction in which the original neutron was moving. So I think this equation or this representation is clear to you, that we have a head-on collision. Here neutron is striking head-on collision with the target nucleus. The target nucleus then starts moving with velocity v2 and in the direction parallel to the direction of the incident neutron. So we can apply the laws of conservation of energy and momentum. All of you know that the energy, kinetic energy before the reaction and kinetic energy of the all the sum of the will be the sum of the kinetic energy after reaction will be the sum of the kinetic energy of all the product molecules that are formed. So we have here the kinetic energy is given by half mv square. So for the neutron it will be given by half m1 u1 square. But since the nucleus was at rest, so u2 is equal to 0. So there will be no contribution for energy on the left hand side for the target nucleus. Similarly, on the right hand side we have two contributions. Kinetic energy of the outgoing particle will be half m1 v1 square, and kinetic energy of the target nucleus, that is after the reaction, is half m2 v2 square. Similarly, we can show the equation of the momentum, conservation of momentum, which will be given by m1 u1 is equal to m1 v1 plus m2 v2. So from here, what can we can have? We can have v1. So v1 will be m1 u1 minus m2 v2 upon m1. So this value of v1 we have substituted in this equation here. And you can see in this equation, half is common on both the sides, left hand side and the right hand side. So half gets cancelled. So we get m1 u1 square is equal to m1. For v1 we have substituted the value m1 u1 minus m2 v2 upon m1. And there is a whole square of v1 square. So we get a square term plus m2 v2 square. So now we take the LCM on both the sides with respect to m1. So we get m1 u1 square is equal to, so when we open up the bracket here, it would be m1 square. So when we open up the bracket, we have m1 square. So 1 m1 and 1 m1 gets cancelled. So we get m1, and here m1 goes to the left hand side as well as it is multiplied with this m2 also. So we have here, opening the square, a minus b ka whole square, we get m1 square u1 square plus m2 square v2 square minus 2m1 m2 v1 v2 plus m1 m2 v2 square. So a very simple simplifications, we get the value of v2. So v2 is nothing but 2m1 u1. Here m1 u1 square, m1 u1 square gets cancelled. So what we get? We get v2 is equal to 2m1 u1 upon m1 plus m2. So let us put this equation as equation number A. So now this experiment was calculated for supposedly first target nucleus. Let it be an A target nucleus, or let it be the first target nucleus. Now we are repeating the same experiment with another target nucleus. Let the nucleus be replaced by 2. So when he had replaced another nucleus, so if since this was having nucleus, first was having a mass m2 and u2 equal to 0, so then the second would be having a mass m3 and u3 equal to 0, and similarly the final velocity will be m3 and v3. So similar calculations will again be carried out. So now we can calculate, instead of v2 we can calculate v3. So v3 will be given by 2m1 u1 upon m1 plus m2. Instead of m2, here it would be replaced by m3. So we get the final velocity of the new nucleus that would be moving after collision. So v3 will be 2m1 u1 upon m1 plus m3. Now we divide both the equations. We take the ratio of v2 and v3. So the ratio of v2 by v3, so this 2m1 u1 and 2m1 u1 gets cancelled. So you get m1 plus m3 upon m1 plus m2. So if we know the values of v2, v3, we know the value of m3, m2, we can calculate the value of m1. And what was m1? M1 was nothing but the mass of the neutron. So Chadwick performed the experiment by using two types of target nucleus. One target nucleus was of the hydrogen, and second target nucleus he chose was to be of the nitrogen. And you know that the mass of hydrogen is 1 amu and mass of nitrogen is 14 amu. And he could calculate the velocity, final velocity of the hydrogen and nitrogen. So he performed the experiment of hydrogen, where he calculated that the velocity of hydrogen is 3.3 into 10 to the power 7 meter per second, and the velocity of the nitrogen calculated was 4.7 into 10 to the power 6 meter per second. Now seeing these values also, we can justify it. Since nitrogen is a heavier than hydrogen, obviously a heavier mass has a lower velocity. So the values also predict here that since the velocity of nitrogen is having a power of 10 to the power 6, whereas hydrogen is having a power of 10 to the power 7. So velocity of hydrogen should be more than the velocity of nitrogen. So putting the values, all the values of V2, V3, M2 and M3, so we get the value of mass of the neutron. So mass of the neutron calculated by the experiment came out to be the value of 1.15 amu. Whereas the mass calculated, for the actual mass calculated theoretically was 1.008665, and the mass of proton was 1.007227, and the mass that came out from the calculation is 1.15. So this 1.15 was more near than the mass to the mass of the neutron. So this mass was in accordance with the mass of the neutron, and this experiment was able to calculate the mass of neutron. So I hope that you have understood the process of how to calculate the mass of neutron. So now what we have to calculate? We have to calculate the wavelength of neutron. So wavelength is always associated with a wave. You must be remembering de Broglie. De Broglie said that a material particle, a particle which has mass, will possess two types of characteristics. It will behave as a particle as well as a wave. So according to de Broglie, all moving particles have wave-like characteristics. If it is having wave-like characteristics, so it should have its frequency, its wavelength and other characteristics of the wave. So from the de Broglie wavelength, we know that the de Broglie wavelength is given by lambda is equal to h upon mv, where h is the Planck's constant and mv is the momentum. M is the mass of the particle, v is the velocity of the particle. We know that energy is given by p square upon 2m. So, p is equal to mnv, momentum is mass into velocity ka square upon 2m. So, what happens? We take this 2m into E and mnv ka whole square. So, this square goes to the other side to form under root. So, mnv is equal to under root of 2mne. So, in this equation, lambda is equal to h by mv, we can substitute the value of mv as 2me. So, he has substituted the value. So, the wavelength of neutron is nothing but h upon mnv, which can be written as h upon 2mne. So, substituting the value of h, that is 6.625 into 10 to the power minus 34 joule seconds. 2 is 2. Mass of the neutron is 1.6744 into 10 to the power minus 27 kg. And E is, we can put the values of energy. So, why did he not put a single particular value of a neutron? Already we have discussed that there are three types of neutron. Slow neutron, fast neutron and thermal neutron. So, depending upon the type of neutron, we have to insert the value of energy. And for that particular energy, it would have different wavelengths. So lambda is given by 0.289. Under root E, Angstrom. So let us consider the case that we are considering the case for thermal neutrons. Already we have discussed that the thermal neutrons are those neutrons which have the energy corresponding to KT. So for KT, we put the value of K 1.3 into 10 to the minus 23. At room temperature, T is having 300 Kelvin. Converting into electron volts, we have 1.6 into 10 to the minus 19 electron volts. So, we get 0.026 electron volt. So, for energy corresponding to 0.026, when we put this value here, so what value we will get for the wavelength? This wavelength will have a value of 1.80 angstrom. So, this value of angstrom, that is 1.8 angstrom, is close to the wavelength of X-rays. And you know that X-rays are used in the diffraction grating, where we have to determine the crystal structures. So, since the wavelength of neutron is comparable to the wavelength of X-rays, so X-rays can be replaced by neutrons for determination of the crystal structures. So, this is the one application of the neutron where we can use neutron in the diffraction for determining the crystal structure. The second type of neutron were the high neutrons or the fast neutrons. So the high energy neutrons or the fast neutrons were regarded when it was having energy very high, more than 1 mega electron volt, ranging to 100 mega electron volts. So when we put the value of E to be 1 mega electron volt to 100 mega electron volt, we calculated the value of wavelength. So the wavelength ranged from 10 to power minus 14 meters to 10 raised to power minus 15 meters. And you must be remembering this factor, 10 raised to power minus 15 meter, that is 1 Fermi. So where did 1 Fermi number came? This 1 Fermi was listed in the nuclear dimension, size of the nucleus. So when we have to determine some size of the nucleus or nuclear dimension, these fast neutrons come into picture. So these high energy neutrons are involved or employed to determine the nuclear size or nuclear dimensions. So there, and the thermal neutrons are used to determine the crystal structures. And third were the slow neutrons. These slow neutrons were having energy less than 1 mega electron volt. Where we need very, very slow neutrons, we can use these slow neutrons. So in this way, we can calculate the wavelength of the neutrons depending upon what type of neutron they are, whether they are fast, whether they are slow, whether they are thermal neutrons. So I hope that you must have understood the concept of neutrons, that what type of neutrons are there, or how neutrons were discovered, what were the properties of neutrons, what are the types of neutrons, how the mass and wavelength of the neutrons can be found out by the derivation So there was an accordance of the theoretical values of the mass wavelength with the practically observed values of mass and wavelength, and these neutrons can be used to determine the crystal structure and the nuclear dimensions. So meet you again soon. Thank you.